Yes. Tim just passed around some program. There's three different photos of Hassan with some sayings that he always used to say a lot.
Right on.
Session. This right here is a session. And tonight will be a session. I love you, B.
Every day and every night we'll be together.
More of a formal thing and something that I wrote and with help of with Tim and Tim's father talking about a song. So I really want to thank you all for being here. I know how far some of you came. No matter how close you were, it's still far because we're here and there's windy roads and everything. And something about a song and the way that he kind of made you work for it every time made this place the right place. And I just said this a second ago, I liked what I said. It's round and not square. this place is special, and we really felt this place. I'm going to let Tim talk about it in a second because he spent a lot of time here. Hassan spent a lot of time in this area when Tim lived here, and he really loved it out here. He would just have bass in the pond, and there's no bass in the pond. So. That's how we know he was never here. I really just want to laugh and be with you all right now. So I'm going to take my time and just talk. So my name is Ben Mahoney. I'm an old friend of Hassan's. And I'm Hassan's brother in a lot of ways. Ganul,
yes.
And Markley are my second parents. I grew up with him since about the sixth grade. I met him when he checked me from behind on the ice hockey rink, and my stick got caught in between the boards and my gut and snapped in half. And then we started fighting, and the rest of the group, the kids on the ice, they had no idea what to do about it because that wasn't allowed. And by the time they'd all gather around in awe and fear and helplessness, Hassan and I were laughing while hitting each other as hard as we could. And we got in trouble, but there's something about it that bonded us forever at that moment, and the rest is kind of history, as they say. So we're at Pompanuck Farm here, and it's a really special place, as I just mentioned. Before I forget, I want to thank Scott and Lisa, who are the owners and proprietors of this place, and they've done something really special with the land, and they've gotten a way of life here that I think Hassan would absolutely appreciate. It's organic, it's heady, it's right on, and it's good for the mind, body, and spirit. They've lost somebody that when we started talking to them, that really reminded them of Hassan, and they're here with us today, also not just as hosts, but grieving for their friend and ours as well, and we can't thank them enough. Some logistic stuff, because that's kind of what I do for a living. We're here up on the hill. If you guys haven't had a chance to see this place, the grounds are ours tonight. They've offered everything to us. There's a couple houses up top that we don't want to mess with, but this yurt here has musical instruments in it for everyone to play. We'll all be getting loose on those later. Down there's the pond. Some of you guys have seen the memorial zone that we created there for Hassan, because he was one of the best fishermen. I think he was the best fisherman I ever met, because I couldn't catch more fish than him in certain places, but he could catch fish anywhere he went, anywhere. And you'll see a lot of the photos tonight. As you move down the hill, we're going to have some Turkish dinner delivered here and served at 5 o'clock. And that's going to be down where we were all gathering earlier by the large roundhouse. We're going to have it outside, and it's going to be in honor of his love for kebab and our love for Ganul and Markley's food that always used to come out at all times of day. And me, as a white boy in upstate New York, was exposed to bareks and kebab very early, and I find that an extreme benefit to my character throughout life. see, it makes me smile. It's a good thing. And so inside that roundhouse, we felt that that was really special. Upstairs, we kind of made Hassan's bedroom, recreated it. There's a picture of Hassan, a large picture of him serving up food on the table in there with some Sharpies. And I encourage everyone to look at his smile, take a pen and write something on that, a farewell of sorts, and have a ginger candy. And there's also some jars down there with a little bit of his hair that Markley put together, which we all know is a very iconic feature of Hassan. So if you're close to Hassan, as we all are, there's limited jars. If that's something that you like, go ahead and take one. There's records upstairs that Hassan loved. We'll be looping video. Up on top, there's a beautiful stone wall. It feels really type of sanctuary. Hassan absolutely loved individual adventure sports. He had style and skill above many. Really good snowboarder, really good skateboarder. He just loved the outdoors. He was a great hockey player, and all that stuff's kind of, we've organized it in a way with photos and artifacts from his life that's up there. So please, as we're here, I'm gonna read this, read the back of the program. I know you can all read. But I wrote it, and I like what it says, and it's I think it's good to say. So, because here we are, we're in honor of memory of Lloyd Hassan Wilson. You know, we gather here today, 9/29. I messed up the date. On the grounds of Pompanuck Farm, Cambridge, to remember and celebrate this amazing individual that we all love so much. You're welcome here today amongst Hassan's loving family and great friends for a ceremony and the celebration of his life in a place that is true to his unique spirit. Everyone is encouraged to wander through the spaces and grounds here today amongst this peaceful setting and the exhibition of the many special mementos, photographs, and remembrances of Hassan. Hassan was one of a kind. He was magnetic, powerfully charismatic, compassionate, devoted, charming, raw, boldly articulate. He was a free thinker, and he was an influencer. Hassan lived life with passion and intensity. As we join here today, in the warm glow of the spirit, we pay respects and say our goodbyes. And this is the most important part. We remember to embrace each other. The faces I see here today, these people, some of you I've never met, but I've heard about you all, and it's so rich. It's powerful. It's love. We'll smile. We'll cry. We'll remember to connect with each other. We'll remember to laugh. We'll remember to session the shit out of tonight. We'll eat. We'll dance. We'll love. And we'll be true to ourselves in good form in the way that Hassan would appreciate. And I think you all know what I mean by that. So I think I just want to check my pad here. There's a couple bathrooms down there. Didn't want to tell you about that. I was just thinking about Hassan's farts for some reason. They're really bad, in case anybody. I'm sorry if that's inappropriate, but I have to say it. He was very proud of his own abilities in that arena. After.
Okay.
Sorry, Tijan, I didn't mean to offend you. Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I'll clean it up for you. So, and then after this, we talked about Turkish dinner, and the night will go on. I wanted to also thank Markley and Ganul for being amazing parents to me and Hassan and bringing that wonderful individual into this world. And I want to thank you all again for being here. I have some other words I'd like to say about Hassan, and I may get to it, I might not. I kind of read what I had to say, and I'm not going to state the obvious about today, and there's a lot of people here I know that will want to say some things about our brother, our your son, nephew, cousin, amazing and influential person that just, I guess the one thing I just want to say about him real quick before I pass the mic, which you're probably all ready for at this point, is that he just, for me, you know, he was that magnetic person, but at the same time, he really enabled me to kind of access my true character that I was given. You know, I have amazing folks, too. I just lost my dad 3 months ago. him and Hassan were hands down, with all my friends too, but those two somehow were able to, my dad instilled a lot in me, my mom instilled a lot in me, and Hassan was able to kind of activate that. He forced me in the way he did, and just inspired is a better word, to just be my best at all times and uphold standards of taking things to the limit where you knew you could go, to exercising your talents, to being passionate about life. And without that, I'd be a very different person. So I don't want to say that because I feel like he had that effect on a lot of people, even within 5 minutes of meeting him, but I spent a lot of time with him. So he was my brother, and I'm going to miss him forever, but he's right here. And I can't wait to hear what you guys have to say about him. I'm going to give this to Tim. You want to say anything now, or do you want to? Yeah. And then we'll kind of start by passing it off to the family, and we'll speak about things.
Thanks, Ben. I'm going to be short with this. It's the last place I want to be, right here, right now. Hassan was my brother, and Ben was my brother. And we all wanted to be like Hassan. You know, he had something truly special. And, you know, you could go to the store and buy, like, a shirt. Hassan would buy the same shirt. His shirt was cooler. That's just... He had a way of reminding you to not take yourself too seriously. Because we can all do that. We take ourselves too seriously sometimes. You walk around and, you know, there's a line that says, stay between these lines. The song's over here. He doesn't care about that line. You all know that. If you find something offensive, I'm sorry. He didn't care. Because it doesn't matter. We need to love each other. And that's what matters. And I loved him. And I'm just sad to see him go. But I want to say one thing. In our lives, we all have things that, you know, addictions. Little, big problems, maybe they're small. I want each and every one of you to just choose one of those and work hard to eliminate it in the name of Hassan. I'm going to turn it over to Markley now.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tim, and thank you, Ben, and thanks to all of you who are here for coming and sharing and hugging and expressing empathy and understanding and love for our son, Hassan. I said not too long ago to someone that this is the most horrible thing that's ever happened to me and my wife, and that's a fact. It is nothing that we expected, it's nothing that we imagined, and there's nothing that is as horrible as this. But your presence, your support, the team from I Love New York, the Lake George High School kids, Deb, the parent of his friends, my brothers and sisters, the expressions that you all have given to us at this time has really, really helped a lot. There have been some delightful things that's happened to us, believe it or not, as an outcome of this. We learned of Hassan's death on Sunday, and on Monday we rushed down to West Palm Beach, where he lived, with the help of Deb and Lori, and did all the things we needed to do during those few days. And on the Friday of that week, 44 individuals from that community had a gathering at a home in his name. And 33 of them spoke about the effect of Hassan on them. Each individual, they talked about his love for the environment, they talked about his love for fishing, they talked about his knowledge about music, his intelligence, his craziness. One of them gave an example of Hassan inviting him to join him. He didn't give him the details. He said, just bring a knife and come with me. They ended up raiding a mango tree of a nearby neighbor. That's the kind of thing that Hassan did. And one of them actually said to us that he would not be alive today if not for Hassan. So many people we have learnt are better and happier, and their life is more enriched because of their connection with our son. And it took his passing to really appreciate that. It's important for you to understand, if you don't know him very well, what he was like. And you certainly will from the display that Ben and the team have organized. But it's also important for you to understand the roots of Hassan. And half of him is from the island of Cyprus. And Ozai Mehmet is the big brother of the Mehmet family. He's sitting here. And you can stand. Yes. Yes. He might have something to say in the future. And his young sister is Gunul, now Wilson, who left Cyprus to come to Barbados. As crazy that as that is, to marry me after we met at college in Windsor, Ontario. That's his mother. And I have from the Wilson clan, who came in from Barbados two nights ago, James, who's after me. And James's wife, Hyacinth. And then after James, there is Megan.
Hi.
Megan Wilson. And then there is Roslyn. Where's Roslyn?
She's there.
Oh, there you are. That's Roslyn. Roslyn. Okay. We also have Lloyd, who is right now at Albany Airport. There was some delay. He's bringing his son from, I don't remember where, but he's on his way in as well. And when you see Lloyd, you'll know he's a Wilson, because people sometimes ask if he's my twin. So I just want you to meet the family.
Dean,
the son of Hyacinth and James. Thank you. Did I miss anyone else? Any more Wilsons?
No.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Andrea Wilson.
Who?
Andrea Wilson.
Andrea?
Andrea.
Who's that?
Wilson of Outrage Royce.
Oh, okay. Oh, but she's not family. Okay, yes. Yes, there is no Andrea Wilson. We have a friend from the show called Andrea Wilson. That's right.
You missed one.
Okay, yes. Yeah. Okay. I'm really impressed with the way in which the high school friends have chosen this location, which represents the spirit of Hassan. And as you walk around and as you look at the photographs, etc., you'll really get a sense of what he was like. And as you talk to them, if you don't, you also will get an idea of that. Some of them, three of them, Ben and Tim, went to the University of Colorado in Boulder together. Are there any others that went to? How many of you?
Yeah, there's actually everybody who went to Boulder. Please, like, raise their hand.
Okay. People from Lake George High School went there. All right, because of Hassan. All right, they all wanted to put you two together. All right, and you will see also as one of the exhibits his snowboarding equipment. He was great at snowboarding, and what Ben said about him being bold and doing things that both Ben and Tim that are outside of the norm is true, and that led to him taking a leap on a snowboard once, which was beyond the norm, and that resulted in him breaking his knee in three places. And there's a photograph about that in the room at the wrong house. But I wanted to bring that up because while it's good sometimes to do things that aren't the norm, sometimes it could be dangerous. And that incident itself led to him being given oxycodone to solve his pain problem. Mm-hmm. And that is the genesis of his addiction. Yes, I said the word addiction. And I'm amazed that the pharmaceutical companies are able to do this because they and the doctors that work for them know that these things cause addiction, but still they give them to them. There are chemicals, there are other things that are available to help people with pain that are not addictive. I've been very involved in studying the subject for the past few days and learned that every day in this country, 87 people die from opioid addiction. And in New England, which is not too far from us, last year, 1,397 people died of opioid overdoses, and 50% of those included fentanyl. So that subject, those pharmaceutical companies and those doctors, I think something needs to be done about it. And I hope that out of this and in his honor, there is a way that we can contribute towards addressing that problem. But it's not all negative. On the 8th of October, we have been invited to Easton, where he lived in Maryland, yes, to another one of these. So we had one in Florida, there's this today, and then there's one in Easton on Saturday the 8th of October. He worked for the health department there. He was very much involved in the Democratic Committee. He was an environmental scientist for a groundwater and environmental consulting company there. And he also founded the Asbury Park Cemetery Project, which was the result of him stumbling on a grave in a forest when he was doing his environmental work, and then doing some research on that grave, and it turned out to have been the grave of some slaves. So he created this organization, which still exists, to honor and protect that gravesite. So that group is having a celebration of Hassan on the 8th. One of the most common comments that I've received from people over and above, I'm sorry for your loss and we empathize with you, is I wish I would have done this or I could have done this, etc. With Hassan or for Hassan, but I've concluded that we all can do that, we all can say that, but that's the way it is. However, there are still Mary and John and Joe and your neighbors and your family and your friends that are with you right now, and just like Ben made a suggestion, I would suggest that you give serious consideration to looking at who's in your environment right now and thinking about things that you would like or should do for them, or even say to them, and do it, because you never know. As parents, I want to thank you all for your presence. You will realize even more from this evening what a wonderful son we have, and I wish for each of you that you experience the positive thing that Gunul and I have agreed on about our son. which is that in spite of his faults, in spite of his craziness, we are all in agreement that when it comes to the content of his character, he gets 100%.
Yes.
Thank you. I know. I think I'm going to call on the old gentleman in the room, Dr. Ozai Mehmet.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark.
The old partner. The old partner.
No mic.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm a lecturer.
Oh dear.
My apologies.
Now,
just to be correct, I'm going to read. Dear friends and family, I am Gönül's elder brother, Ozai Mehmet, and I carry responsibility for her being in North America. She was 18 when I invited her to come from Turkish part of Cyprus and live with us in Windsor, Ontario, as Mark mentioned, and to go to college there, where she met her future husband, Mark, a fellow student at the same college. My wife, Karen, and I also are in some way responsible for Gönül's and Mark's eventual marriage. Their decision to marry was taken in Windsor, Ontario. It was, of course, purely their decision. But Karen and I blessed it and rejoiced in their marriage and shared their sad moments and their joys all these years, especially on the joyous part of the history, their wonderful children, Tijen and Hassan. Hassan, as we heard from his friends, was a special person, a unique individual, a beautiful black Afro-American of Caribbean and Turkish Muslim roots.
Yeah.
Yes.
Who could be more unique than that? Yeah. Hassan was full of energy. He loved sports,
especially later.
The more daring, the better. And in particular, he loved outdoors. Yes. And I have to say, Gönül, Mark, Tim, Ben, you could never have chosen a more appropriate location to remember and to honor Hassan than this particular location. Hassan's life and message, the way I see it, is huge and relevant to what is America today. I'm a Canadian living in the North, but every night on CNN and the news media, we are bombarded with news about America. We know what is going on. What I will now share with you is my interpretation.
Please.
Racism and racial violence are tearing apart American cities and communities. We see this every day. Shooting by police of Afro-Americans. Is the USA descending into a racial civil war? I hope not. Hassan lived in difficult times. His message to us is clear. I don't know all the details, but I have to tell you, Hassan, growing up in Lake George, encountered racism early in school. He was called nigger by fellow students years ago. He fought back the injustice. Yonul was furious. It was shocking that the principal wanted to ignore racism in the school and punish Hassan for his refusal to accept it. Hassan was punished for violence. Yonul, the loving mother, could not stomach this. So the family uprooted and moved to Brooklyn, New York. But in the meantime, Hassan's energy and love of life prevailed. He became friends on the hockey team, in sports, especially with Ben. You have heard about it. This friendship has lasted a lifetime. Ben and Hassan became the best of friends. This beautiful friendship is the very reason we are gathered here in this memorial service here today. The friendship of Hassan and Ben, to me, is a big deal. Reconciliation is urgently required in today's America. Just as Ben and Hassan overcame racism and became lifelong friends, so racism in the USA must end. Healing, understanding, and friendship across racial boundaries must triumph. Ben and Hassan demonstrated this. Muslims believe that death is not the end. It is rather the beginning of eternal life, earned from goodness in this temporal life. Hassan, during his all too brief life, fought injustice within himself and in his community of friends. His soul lives on, as does his message of healing and friendship. As for us, still here, whether Christian, Jew, Muslim, we all believe in one and the same God. Let Hassan's message guide us all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ozan. That was powerful. Necessary. Kunul, Mom, would you like to say anything next? You don't have to. I just want to make sure that.
Thank you. Thank you, Dad.
Yeah, please. I'm a little bit nervous to give you the mic, but.
He's afraid I'll never sit down. In case you don't notice, I'm Ben's mom. I'm not black. I'm not Turkish. I'm Norwegian, Irish. God knows what that's mixed in there.
We're mutts, Mom.
I have three black sons. I have two that I semi-adopted when they were 12, and I had Hassan. Lloyd Hassan Wilson. I was his other mom.
Yes.
Ganul was the most nurturing, caring, forgiving, giving mother that anyone on this earth could have. I was the other side. I was the crazy, entrepreneurial, fast-paced home life, and if you do that, I'll break your arm if you do it again. So there's a lot of my kids out here that are standing here.
Mom and Dad.
Who have practically lived at my house from the time they were small boys. I just want to take just a moment to talk about this Hassan right here. This Hassan in this picture and in this picture. I'm not only sad, but I'm very, very angry. And it hasn't been able to leave me because I lost one of my boys, Stewie. Him, Ben. I can go on and on. They've all stayed at my house. How could I lose one of my boys? It just doesn't seem real to me, and I'm angry about it. One of my sons, his son was a fixture in our home from the time he was 11 years old. And literally, if he weren't at Mark Lee and Ganul's getting fed Barex until they could almost get sick, they were at my house eating sandwiches and spaghetti and God knows what. Anyone who knew Hassan knew him to be handsome, incredibly magnetically handsome. Intelligent, extremely inquisitive about everything. Crazy, crazy for life. He had to have every single bit of it. He had to engulf it to the fullest that he could. He was kind, giving, caring, and with a smile that could charm the world. I was going to say charm a snake, but I didn't know how that would go over. So I said the world. He could charm me, especially when I had them in the house terrorizing the place sometimes, or my younger son. God knows, I still don't know what they did to him. Totally to this point in my life. But I would turn around and I'd say something, and I'd go, Hassan, you too. And I'd get this look. Right here. With that smile, like, I didn't do it, I'll never do it again. And wasn't me. He would just give me that look, sort of head down and looking up with that charming grin. Like, you sure you're talking about me? Hassan, like Ben, was a pure adventure. And Tim and Stewie, you all gave me gray hairs. I'll dye my hair now to the day I die. Always looking for something to conquer. If it weren't sports, it could have been world hunger. He had such a passion in his heart that I can't explain. If you look at his face here, you'll see what I used to see. When I talked to him sometimes, I saw this beautiful, wonderful, bright side. And then I'd see this other side that was so incredibly serious. I didn't know where it came from. I didn't know what he was thinking. One minute, I'd see him out railing a railing of a stairway on a skateboard, flipping over and almost crashing his skull on the ground. And the next minute, you could see him picking up a baby bird, maybe, that had fallen from a nest, doing everything he could to get it healthy again. There was surely a happy adventure side, and there was the precocious side when he was younger that I could always see. I saw him when he was a boy. At times, he seemed way beyond his years. sometimes I'd look at him when they were talking and conversing, and I'd listen in, and Hassan always had this pensive look. I mean, I just could never figure out what was there, and I did try hard, believe me. There was kind of a wall there sometimes. There was kind of a wall because he had something inside that he wanted to let out. And that's my view of it. I loved him. I love him now.
And he loved you, Debbie. He loved you.
Getting a little dry here. Two Sundays ago, I was driving home from Marklene Ganul's. I'd had the call that Hassan had passed. I don't know if I can say that I was totally surprised, but I was angry and I was sad and in shock and mourning the loss. And I left that day after doing everything I could. What do you do with parents who've lost not only a son, but a son like Hassan Wilson? And in the car on the way back to Albany, I had the radio on and I was trying to just get a grasp on it and not be so angry. I'm going to be a bit of an old lady here. And it's because a song came on the radio that brought it all together for me. I don't know if I know that some of you here remember Peter, Paul, and Mary, singers. The song was on the radio, and I don't think I ever listened to it before. In all the years that I've heard this song, I never really listened to it. I found myself turning up the radio, and I decided that night that I was going to say the words to that song here in front of you today. And I didn't care how long it took, but I was going to say it. If I sing it, you'll all be down getting to eat faster than you should be and leaving. But I want to read these words, and I want you to think about how Hassan cared about humanity and life. How many roads must man walk down before they call him a man? How many seas must a white dove sail before he sleeps in the sand? How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned?
Dylan.
The answer, my friend, blowing in the wind. The answer, blowing in the wind. How many years must a mountain exist before it's washed to the sea? How many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free? How many times can a man turn his head and pretend that he just doesn't see? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. How many times must a man look up before he can see the sky? And how many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? How many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. I don't know if it'll help you to understand why we're here today, but it sure as heck helped me. I'm less angry now. Thank you, Hassan. I think you did that for me. To his loving other mom, we will so miss him. And his father, Mark Lee, and most of the beautiful human beings, all of his friends, Tim and Stewie and Ben, all the work you've done to make this happen. I love you all. I love everyone for being here. And I will always have Hassan in my life. Always. God bless you.
Too many people died. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Let's talk about a song. Come on, John. This is John Oakley, Tim's dad.
I'm going to need a mic. I did not know Hassan well, but I witnessed Hassan grow up in Lake George with my son Tim Oakley and Ben Mahoney. Thank you, Tim and Ben, for your love and your steadfast devotion to Hassan
through the good years and the not so good years. Yesterday I asked Tim and Ben to give me a few words that described Hassan, and their reply was emphatic. One of a kind. There was no one like Hassan. Magnetic. Anyone who knew Hassan knew he was magnetic. Powerful. If you played any sport with Hassan, you knew he was powerful. Charismatic. If you fell under the spell of Hassan's Hollywood smile.
Thanks for coming out.
Charismatic. Devoted. If you witnessed Hassan's deep love for his sister, to Jen
Wilson.
To Jen Wilson.
Yes.
He was devoted.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely devoted to Jen Wilson. Charming. If you engaged in Hassan's passions, charming. Charming. Raw. If you watched Hassan push any envelope, anywhere, anytime, raw. Boldly articulate. If you truly listened to Hassan, boldly articulate, like his dad. Free thinker. If you discussed almost any subject with Hassan, you learned quickly that he was a free thinker. And game changer, I love this one. If you joined Hassan in almost any activity, you would know Hassan was a game changer. We all loved Hassan in one way or another. And some of us are angry at Hassan for not taking better care of himself, for leaving us with this grief. Damn it, Hassan, you left us way, way, way too soon. Thank you, Mark Lee. Thank you, Ganul, for bringing Hassan into our lives. Please know that Hassan, who was all these things mentioned and many more, will continue in many of us, in many ways, for many years to come. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, my name is James Wilson. I'm Mark Lee's brother. It's Mark Lee, James, Megan, Lloyd, Roslyn, and they're all here. Lloyd will be here in a few minutes. I just want to say a few things. I've heard so much about Hassan.
Bring the mic up.
Is this better?
Yeah.
I've heard so much about Hassan, Lloyd Hassan Wilson. Lloyd is our father's name, and Mark Lee was kind enough to add it to Hassan's name. I just want to say one thing that is really important. Hassan was very kind, very informative, very adventurous. But I'll say that Hassan has lived his life fully. Mm. For what I understand, it's not how old you are or what you've done. But in his short 36 years, he's accomplished a lot. He's done all he had to do on this earth, and he's gone on to other things. Jen Wilson, that's my opinion of He's done all he had to do. There's nothing else on this earth he can do. So that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Please.
One day I got a mailer, and it was an I Love New York book. So I'm sitting there, and I'm doing 12 things, and I'm flipping through the book, and all of a sudden, I see this crazy handsome guy with a big fish. And I thought, that looks like Hassan, but it can't be. Yeah. So I called Mark Lee, and sure enough, it was Hassan. So I don't know how he ended up in there, but I thought, there can't be two men on this earth that can fish that well, and they're that handsome.
Anyone else? Did you want to say something?
I just remember how much he loved food. He cooked all the time. And staying the night there, and Mark Lee would be up in the middle of the night and be like, why is your dad up? And he's like, he's cooking. And he talked about his parents a lot, and I knew how they met. And I guess one thing I would just say is that I knew how much people would love Hassan, and we had a great time together. And it was nice because we mutually decided to move on. And he was getting ready to go to Boulder. I'm like, Hassan, people are going to love you. All the ladies, the way you smell, your hair. And I loved him very much, and I know he loved me. And I just am happy to have been part of his life. And I know he'll always be with me.
I do want to say something. Thank you.
Did you want to start?
I hope you can hear me. If you can, thank you. First of all, I want to thank each and every one of you for coming all this way to celebrate the life of our son. Hassan was very, very special, as you can see in some ways, and some ways you cannot see. He was full of life, and he was a genuinely good person. What Mark said about the accident in 2002 did change his, I guess, attitude towards life, and it became a part of him that he tried very hard. But that did not make him. That's just a very small part of him. He tried, and whoever he met, he really, truly did the best he can to appreciate the person he was talking to. One of the things that came out last Friday when we were talking to, I guess a lot of people would call them addicts, but these are, most of them, very young people who are dealing with their own challenges. One of them said that Hassan could talk to a homeless person and then turn around and talk about the environment or topics that a lot of them did not know anything about, and how much they learned from him. I knew my son was very special all along, but hearing it from so many different people is making me feel that, just like James said, it is not the amount of years that he lived, but his impact on each and every person that he came in contact with. He will never leave me, ever. And he and I, we had a very special relationship, and I will miss him terribly, but I'm also very, very, very proud of who he was and his memory, his love, and his being of a genuine person. Again, I want to thank you for coming, to Ben, to Tim, to everyone for being here. And his love will keep me going. You know, I have Tijen, and I just, you know, it's very difficult, but I don't wish this on anyone. And we have to appreciate life and do the best we can and not judge anyone. Thank you.
Well, hi everyone. My name is Nick Cladis, and I went to high school with Hassan and graduated from Lake George with him. And thank you to everyone who's came today and said such amazing things about our good friend Hassan. I didn't write anything down. I didn't think about it on the drive here, and so what I'm going to say is just going to come from my heart, and I'm definitely not very good at public speaking. So, man, Lloyd Hassan Wilson. I never had a friend named Lloyd or Hassan, and I definitely never had a friend that looked as good as him in so many different ways, inside and outside. So I moved to Lake George in 1996 from Westchester County, New York, and that was quite the experience in and of itself, and was lucky enough to live a few doors down from Ben, and met Hassan through Ben, and instantly was just like, wow, look at this guy. Like, what an amazing looking guy. I mean, that hair, that smile, we could go on and on. Charismatic. He was amazing. I mean, I remember probably about 15 years ago begging him to marry my sister. I'm not joking. I'm really not. Not at all. Not in the least bit. She's still single. She didn't listen to me. So, yeah, I mean, Tim said it perfect. We all wanted to be as cool as Hassan. What a great guy. So some fun memories. Yeah, Hassan liked to cook, definitely. My parents had a nice home with a nice chef's kitchen and pretty nice amenities. And I remember like 2 o'clock in the morning, somehow we ended up back at my house with my mother sleeping upstairs. And my dad, who is the male version of Mama Deb, definitely no BS going on there. But Hassan noticed that there was some prosciutto and some white Vermont cheddar cheese and a dozen of eggs from Stewart's in my refrigerator and a flat cooking surface, a griddle top, I guess you'd call it, and busting out omelets at 3 o'clock in the morning with my mother opening up her door upstairs and saying, what the hell are you doing down there? And I remember saying, it's just Hassan. Go back to bed. Or do you want us to go somewhere else? And, you know, slamming spatulas and making all this noise and, like, a dish rag hanging out of his back pocket. And just like he was a line chef. I mean, it was amazing. I remember telling him to be quiet and him laughing at me and being louder. Because why do you care so much, Gladys? Are your parents going to get pissed that you're home and not somewhere God knows where? How do you want your omelet? Dirty Greek. That's right, I'm Greek, so I love my Turkish, Cyprus friends. Nothing but love. And I just want to, I know I'm rambling, so I'll keep going, but so Hassan taught me how to snowboard at Okemo Snow Resort in Vermont. And I remember him screaming at me as I was coming down the mountain, saying, hold like you're holding a beer ball. Going like this down the mountain and screaming, yes! Right on, you filthy Greek! And the people in the chairlifts above us laughing, and I was so embarrassed. But then he'd say, why do you care so much? Shut up. And that's what I loved about him. Mark Lee and Ganul, without a doubt, beautiful parents. Dijen, Hassan was Wilson. Every time I see Hassan, I'd always ask about you guys. How's Dijen? And he would go into a half hour, hour long discussion about how great you're doing and how proud he was of you and is of you and everything that you have going for you. And Mark Lee and Ganul, the bereks early in the morning. Yeah. Never had a Turkish experience. And Mark Lee working out on a treadmill at like midnight one time in Wappingers Falls, where we were hanging out downstairs, and I remember you coming down and just wanting to work out. And I looked at Hassan and said, what the hell is he doing? He said, he's working out. It's my dad. I loved it. But anyway, thank you so much. Last, I want to thank Ben and Tim Oakley for, look at this place. I mean, it's so right on. It's so awesome. I could feel him pulling in my car, like slamming my dashboard at the gravel driveway and the roundhouse in front of us. Like I could just hear him saying, right on. So thank you, everyone. Everyone who's a friend of Hassan is always a friend of mine. And I'm sure we all share that common love for Hassan. So somebody come up here and show me up. Let's have some fun here and say some great stories. Thank you.
I'm Dustin. Believe it or not, if you know me, I'm not comfortable talking, but if you know me, I don't shut up. So it's probably pretty hard for a lot of people to believe that. I just wanted to, I didn't know if I was going to talk today, but I just wanted to say some things that about a song that really was important to me. In high school, everybody would always go over to Hassan's house after school. The food, the welcome atmosphere, it was, and now I'm not going to name any names, but I did go to school with some other Turkish mothers who had students in our class, and your food was always better. Not the thing, just however, so Hassan, music to Hassan was like air, was like just breathing to us.
Yes.
I never really appreciated a lot of the things that Hassan kind of taught me. A lot of my influences from early on were because of, we would sit in his car in his, I believe it was a Datsun.
Yes.
Pickup truck that was so dangerous. No 16-year-old or 18-year-old should be driving this vehicle, but we would sit there and listen to tapes, and he'd have this cooler full of tapes. We'd sit there at West Mountain parking lot and just listen to tapes for 40 minutes, an hour, hour and a half. And he'd say, listen to the drums. No, shut up. Listen to the drums. And I'd be like, oh, you're right. That's amazing. And just some of the things that like I remember, like no matter where you went, no matter where you, Killington, Okemo, didn't matter. Wherever, whatever room you went into, Hassan was the coolest guy there. Like Hassan was just the coolest guy in the room. You wanted to kind of, you know, kind of like what Tim was saying earlier, it's just, what is he doing? Because I want to do that too. I'll never forget the gyros and the sweet potato pies in Albany. The tighter the cellophane wrap was on that sweet potato pie, the fresher it was. You know, it was 3 a.m. I have a nickname. I'm not going to get into that. But half of you people don't know me by Dustin. But if I gave you my nickname, you'd be like, oh, I met you
shit pants
at so and so.
Shitty pants.
Shitty pants.
Shitty pants.
That's it. I will argue all day how I got that nickname. It's not real, but that's my name. And I'll say, and if you look like, I don't know you.
Yeah.
The shitty pants? Oh, I remember you from. So, Hassan, and me just thinking, and then and some of the things that you were saying, that he had a. People in Maryland had their ceremony, and people in Florida had, no matter where he went, didn't matter how long he was there, he just influenced so many people. He touched so many people that I don't know how long he was in Florida, but the fact that they threw together a service for him just speaks so much. You know, like I said, it didn't matter what it was, he was the best at it. If it was skateboarding, if it was snowboarding, if it was playing the drums, devil sticks or hacky sack, whatever it was, like he was the best at it, and it just didn't make sense. Like I don't get it, but that was the song, and that's how I remember him. I remember going down and visiting him in Maryland, and he had this bag of, well, his spices were always just everywhere in the kitchen, just everywhere. You didn't know what was what. And he had this whole bag, and he's like, "This is called stevia. The government is hiding it from us, but I'm telling you, this is the best sweetener." And now all you see is stevia in the markets. I'm like, where do you even find this stuff? But Hassan had it years before it was even being marketed. And that's just the kind of person he was. It you'd go into his refrigerator and it would be food and crab bakes. And I mean, it was just great. And everything I remember about Hassan is... I wanted to do that. I wanted to be like that. And, you know, it's just, it's unfortunate, but thank you.
Thank you.
I also didn't prepare anything to say today. I also don't want to be standing here today. I was Hassan's girlfriend for a few years. You know, I know there are a lot of people out here that loved him, and that's one of the things that's so wonderful about being here today, is to be surrounded by all these faces that meant so much to him. When I first met Hassan, he was actually here in Cambridge, New York. It was at a festival that Tim, my brother-in-law, would put on every year. I miss Rexley Mill Fest. Maybe you can bring it back now in the spirit of Hassan. But,
you know, when I met him, my sister was like, you know, you should meet Hassan. You really like him. And, you know, I was like, no way, this guy's way too handsome. He always gets the girls. Like, no way, I'm not going for it. You know, we end up living together for a year and dating for 4 years. And, you know, I fell in love with him, as we all did. He's one of the most charming people I've ever met. That smile, his kindness, it's unparalleled. I felt honored to stand in his light, you know, that someone as cool and as amazing as Hassan was wanted to spend time with me too. When we first started dating, you know, it's funny, I can't remember, Deb, I think you mentioned the baby bird. When we first started dating, he sent me a video on the Eastern Shore. There's a lot of turtles, and they, you know, are crossing the road, and they often get hit by cars, and Hassan would make a practice of stopping his car when he saw a turtle in the middle of the road and picking it up and carrying it to the other side. And, you know, I think that he sent me a video of that when we first started dating. And, you know, I know he knew what he was doing. That was a I can't imagine. I was probably not the only girl to receive a video of his son moving a turtle to the other side of the road. But, I mean, that was the kind of person he was. Loved the ladies, but, you know, loved the turtles, too. He would have done it. He would have done it if no one was watching. And, you know, I've said this to many people, and other people have said it to me. It's so sad that such an amazing person, you know, that we lost him to something as horrible as this. There will never be another person like Hassan in this world. I'll never meet another person like Hassan. And I'm just so happy to be here with everyone sharing, you know, these wonderful memories of him, because he really was a wonderful, wonderful person.
Thank you, honey.
Anybody else want to say any words?
All right, 95% of you people here probably have no idea who I am. Truthfully, this is my backyard. Not technically, but I grew up about 4 to 6 miles down the road. I moved east of Maryland about 15 years ago. During that time, I ran into Hassan, and we became friends like this. In some ways, I took the place of some of you fellows down there. We were inseparable, kind of. There were many times where we went out together, and some of the people around there labeled us the cutest couple of East. I can't even begin to explain how much I was there for him, how much he was there for me. We were two strangers in a new town. We just hit it off like no tomorrow. Two totally opposite ends of the spectrum. If he knew where I came from, totally different than where he came from. But it didn't matter. We both saw each other as who we were. He would tell me stories about, as you brought up before, some racism remarks and things like that. Knowing where he came from, what he was like, skateboarder, snowboarder. I had a conversation with him one day, and this conversation consisted of that, you know, he told me stories about how he would get segregated because he was black, but yet he was not African American. I sat with him and told him in this conversation, I do not look at you as a black person. I don't look at anybody like that. He proceeded to tell me that, you know, he was appreciative of that because the race has no bearings, you know, in my life. We also have this thing in common where we both like very hot wings. There was always a competition on who could make the hotter wings and who was going to hurt who more. And there was one night where I played a joke on him, and I put pure capsaicin oil on wings. No flavor whatsoever. We both ate about 4 wings apiece, and we both woke up at about 3 o'clock in the morning texting each other about how bad our stomachs hurt.
I hate those wings. I hate your wings.
Throughout the rest of the night. I will cherish my time with Hassan in Maryland always. He was a brother to me, always will be. Also, I hear the dinner bell ringing, so that's going to cut me kind of short, even though I wasn't going
much
further.
Take your time, man.
I got to meet very wonderful people through Hassan. Many of them are not here. Mike, one great person. Annie, Ben, Tim, Colin, Stu, I heard a lot about you. Nice to finally meet you. Of course, Markley and Ganul and Tijen Wilson. And if there's anybody else I forgot, I'm sorry, but it's good to meet all of you, and it's great to see some of you again, even though these are the worst of circumstances. But it is a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much.
Go ahead, man. Wrap it up.
All right.
Take us to the next stage.
So before we go and eat, this is truly in the spirit of Hassan. You know, if you were around Hassan, there are certain sayings that he had. If you spent any time with him at all, you know this.
Well, if you're friends of Hassan.
No.
Maybe everybody.
Pretty much anyone.
Yeah.
Right. It doesn't matter.
My mom says right on at this point.
So, yeah. So we're all going to say right on right now together. We're going to say, oh, right on. But we're going to do it with as much love and spirit and just energy that Hassan, we're gonna send him off proper right now. Okay? So we're gonna say, oh, right on, together. Okay, you guys got that?
Yes.
All right. So here we go. On three. One, two, three.
There is one question I'd really love to ask. Is there a place for the hopeless sinners who has hurt all mankind? Just a savior's own belief.
One love.
What about a one heart?
One heart.
What about
let's get together and feel alright.
As it was in the beginning,
one love,
so shall it be in the end.
One heart.
Alright.
Thanks and praise to the Lord,
and I will
feel